then we were just going through this big strategic planning process at that time. And this is 2010, and I wanted to know what was 2020 going to look like. You know, management team away, came back with a whole lot of key performance indicators, goals and ambitions of where we thought we were going to be. And then I looked at him and I said, gee, Bea Haggard, for those of the Jim Collins fans know, it's got to be at least a 50% chance of getting there, right? So it's got to be a good stretch. And I looked at this and I thought, this is a pretty good stretch for him. So then I said, okay, well, let's sit down again and say, well, now let's put the shareholder hat on of the foundation. What does that actually mean for the foundation if they're able to achieve this aspiration? And I worked out that, you know, doing some numbers on this, if we hit those numbers, we could fund 1 million people out of poverty through microfinance programs. I got my CFO to do all the modelling. I then gave the modelling to the CFO of Opportunity to go through and double check and making sure we had all our thinking right around it and got comfortable that that would work. So then we got all our posters done for our BHAG that we shared throughout the office, and right in the middle of it was fund 1 million people out of poverty. And we shared it with the staff, and then we said, well, what sort of organisation do we need to be? What sort of values do we have to hold if we're going to truly represent an organisation that does that? So this one, we did the deep dive into all the value structure and making sure we had the values right. Then we did all the education components with our staff and our leadership team and brought them all together along the journey. About 3 months later, the head of HR had come and see me, and she said, I've got to share with you something significantly changed in our business. And I said, what's that? And she said, well, you know, we used a methodology called top grading, which is a recruiting process about how to find A-grade players, the top 10% in the marketplace looking for a job at that particular salary range. And we were very sophisticated in our recruiting process to get to that top 10. And when we did, there was other companies who were smart enough to work out who they were too, and we'd win 50% and lose 50%. She said, since we started sharing the story about our purpose and our 1 million people out of poverty, we're winning 9 out of 10 of the talent.
Wow. Wow. All right. The millennials.
And yeah, the millennials, exactly right. Yeah. And the ones that were losing is because salary got blown out. So I go, wow, that's really interesting. Okay, so what does that mean? If we've got talent, this is the development now into the virtuous circle model. Because if you've got talent, how does it get expressed into business that's going to be meaningful? Well, it does. And often you hear companies say people are our greatest assets. But ask them the question, how do you actually turn that into something that's meaningful at the end? And they can't do it. They just waffle into the distance. So the way that I approached it is that we were doing a net promoter score. This is down in 2010 we're talking about, long before anybody else was ever looking at. On a scale of 1 to 10, how likely would you refer Silver Chef to a friend or a colleague? Mm-hmm. So. And the second question, of course, was, tell us the reasons why you voted the way you did. So we did our first run of it, and we got 35 points. Mm-hmm. Now, Audi Australia was 43, and BMW Australia was 45 at that stage. So I said, if we can get to 45 points, there's a bonus in it for you. And all the staff. Bang, guess what? We got to 45. Oh, shit, that worked. All right. So what about if we make every single staff member get a reward or recognition, financial reward, a bonus, based around customer satisfaction. So we put that system in place. And so our customer satisfaction levels kept going up. Now, we currently sit at 65. All right, so, and then that is in, for those who are in the know, it's sort of in the top 5% in the world. No, so it's extraordinary levels of customer satisfaction that's coming through. So this is the virtuous circle, right? So you get to the stage of you're creating a purpose that is greater than any of us as an individual can share in. So, but we have to act as a collective to enable that to happen. And then when you do that, you attract great talent. When you get the talent, you then get the talent to be expressed in customer satisfaction. Once you get customer satisfaction, your repeat business is massive. So our repeat business is extraordinary that we get in our business, which of course creates economic value. Which means the foundation shareholding goes up in value, and so does its dividends to do more social good. So you can see how it's continually looped all the way around. The staff started getting really excited about this. After a couple of years in, they came and said, listen, we want to change the BHAG. We want to make it 1.5 million. We want to be able to, we'll get our own groups together and we'll fundraise to get to the extra 500,000. Hallelujah, I'm up for that, let's do that. And they did, and so every team every month would then do an individual fundraiser, and then they'd get all their suppliers in and they'd take money off them, and we're just, and then about 3 years ago, 2.5 years ago, we then said, well, what about getting our customers involved? How could we do that? And someone said, well, could we round up their rental payments, their weekly rental payments, and round it up to the nearest dollar? So I sat down and played with that, and that was too complex. So let's just keep it simple. Let's just add $1 onto every rental contract. We write to the customer as part of their option, tick in, do you want, here's our goal, this is what we're trying to achieve, will you join us on this journey? And we've now got 8,000 customers contributing $1 a week, all towards the 1.5 million people out of poverty number. And so as of a few weeks ago, we're currently seeing 1.25 million is where we're sitting, and so we've still got a number to go, so we've got a fair degree of confidence that we're going to get there. But it's been done as a collective, you know, because now we've got customers, we've got shareholders, we've got staff all together sharing a vision and a purpose about something that is bigger than any of us as an individual could ever accomplish. Yet as a shared experience, it's attracted such wonderful, talented people into the business, particularly as you mentioned about Tim White. That they are so much on the money that they want it all. They want to have a career, they want to make good money, and they want to change the world. If you can provide all three for them, you'll win the talent. And that's going to be the secret about how business itself moves forward now, about bringing purpose into the organisations and what it might look like. And this is where the B Corporation movement came in. So from our perspective, you know, we'd done a lot of the work in the people area. We had the purpose element right. We'd won, you know, great places to work competitions and all those sorts of things that were around at the time. And my younger daughter rang me up and said, I really think you should have a look at this B Corporation. It sounds like you. All right, so I started doing investigating the B Corps. And I found my tribe. there's around the world, there's 2,500 business leaders